Welcome to the webinar jointly hosted by the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, the Regional Outreach Bureau of Kerala and Lakshadweep Region, and Kendra Vidyalaya Pattam. Permit me to start the program remembering the words of Glenn Close, a famous actress and a social leader. What mental health need is more sunlight, more candor, and more unashamed conversation. The current global health emergency due to COVID-19 has impacted the mental health of millions of people. Children too are no exception. The transition away from physical classes has significantly disrupted the lives of students and their families, posing a potential risk to the mental well-being of children. An abrupt change in the learning environment and limited social interactions and activities has posed an unusual situation for the children. Today's discussion will be addressing a few of these issues. Let me introduce the panel to you. The moderator and the organizer of this outreach program is Madam K. A. Bina. She is an officer in the Indian Information Service and is also an author, journalist, and columnist. She is a recipient of many regional and national awards. The expert panelist for today's session is Madam Aparna Vishwanath, founder and managing director of Socio, an organization working extensively in the social, emotional health, and learning space. She is a social entrepreneur who has been facilitating health support through interactions and interventions, especially during the COVID times. Aparna Vishwanathan has passed out of the Premier Business School, IIM Bangalore, with a second rank, and is also the gold medal winner in communication and journalism. The program is co-hosted by Kendra Vidyalaya Pattam and has 40 students as participants from both the shifts. This is a live program and is simultaneously being recorded and transmitted through Facebook and YouTube. May I now invite the principal of the Vidyalaya, Sri S. Ajay Kumar, for the welcome address. Sir, please.
So, good evening, all of you. Most respected Aparna Vishwanathan, Madam. I'm Madam Bina. Staff members, Mr. Faisal, Madam Rashmi, my children, my dear children. It's a matter of pleasure for me to be with you on the occasion of a discussion about mental health. Actually, this mental health is an issue. Being a principal, what I feel in a school, the most important topic to be discussed is about mental health only. It's not only during this COVID season, it is to be discussed in other conditions are also. We were discussing for the pre-corona time also, we were discussing about the mental health of children, because children are coming from different strata, different age group and different things. And so they have, many of these children are having different issues and different problems, even serious mental health issues were there even before this COVID season also. We were discussing about that. That's the reason why we are appointing counselors in the schools. And this is actually the most important topic to be discussed among students and parents also. So on this occasion, it's my pleasure to welcome both the dignitaries here, both are experts in this field. And as far as Bina Madam is concerned, I think no introduction is required in this Vidyalaya. Madam frequently talked to my children. I think recently she talked to children about some stories, and children were asking thousands of questions to Bina Madam. And they were not leaving Bina Madam also. I know that last webinar I was sitting with Madam, that children were not at all leaving. And finally, Madam was forced to leave. So that many questions Madam faced from the children of KV Pattam. I welcome Madam Bina.
Thank you.
And Aparna Madam, Vishwanathan Madam, actually she is an educationist, a pure educationist also. I consider her as a pure educationist. That's the reason why she is taking up this topic. To welcome Madam Aparna Vishwanathan also, and I welcome all the staff members and students, and I welcome especially my staff members, Rashmi Madam and Faisal Sir. They used to conduct so many webinars. They conducted many webinars here. So I welcome both of them, and a meaningful webinar for the children as well as the parents. I welcome all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. May I now invite Madam Bina to initiate the discussion now. Madam, please.
Respected Ajay Kumar sir, Faisal sir, Rashmi ma'am, and dear Aparna and my dear children. Once again we are meeting. Last month I feel it was a very pleasure day time for me with children. This time we are coming with another subject, that is mental health. And I'm not giving any introduction because Aparna is there. She is my dear student and an expert in this field. So I now invite Aparna, and meanwhile I will also talk to you. I'm inviting Aparna to start the program.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, teachers. Thank you, principal. Thank you, students, for joining me. A small introduction into what I do and what Socio does in the field of mental health. Socio was formed in 2010, primarily to work in the social emotional learning space, something we have only heard of but haven't dealt with extensively in the educational space. So very subtly, we focus on subjects that we are about to speak about today with children. And this extends to teachers, parents. The facilitated program is such that our programs are run parallel to your academic curriculum. So these are workshop-based programs where we identify issues, concerns within children, within the fraternity, where they find it difficult to express their emotions, where they find it difficult to kind of socially include themselves in certain environment, where they might find it difficult to adapt to certain situations and conditions. So this is broadly what I do, and this is broadly what Socio does in this field. Now, rather than me talking about what we do and how we address issues, I would really love to have the children talk to me here, come up with their concerns if they have any, share with us the experiences that they've been through in the last 6-7 months of being indoors, not being out there with their physical activity and with their peer groups. So as and when we kind of get questions, I would try and address them so that people who are listening to us also would be able to kind of relate to it, identify themselves with such situations, and we will go along like that. I hope that is fine, Bina ma'am. Yeah, so can we have the students come up with their questions?
Myself, sir? Yeah.
Yes, yes. Yes, me, madam.
Okay, we can start with the question.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Shall I begin with shift 2?
Yeah.
Is there any order for the children? You prepared any order or like that? Question?
No.
Or they're order. Just asking?
They'll be just
asking. They'll just ask. Yeah, okay, yeah. Then. Yeah.
Let me start.
Yes.
Yeah.
Varsha Nandini. Ridhya. Ridhya.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, please. You can switch on the video.
And audio.
Yes, yes. Thank you. Please ask your question.
Ma'am, my question is, how can children deal with intrusive thoughts, that is unwanted thoughts?
Okay. Ridhya, I would like you to be online, Ridhya. So I have one more question to you before you log off. Okay, Ridhya, when you say unwanted thoughts, can you give me examples, one or two examples of what kind of thoughts are coming to you, or what kind of thoughts have your friends shared with you?
I think everybody experiences it. It's mostly negative thoughts, any kind of negative thoughts.
Is it because of the pandemic, or is it like in general?
In general.
In general, okay. Now, which standard are you in?
10th standard.
Okay. Now I would give you certain background to why certain people might experience bad thoughts or why you're pushed into thinking in a different pattern. One is the circumstances or the experiences that you are currently facing or the bad experiences that have left a scar in you might lead you to kind of revisit certain experiences again and again, which would lead you to think maybe not in the right healthy manner. One. Two is if you are watching or consuming too much of negative news, too much of horror movies or too much of things that would give you or give you circumstances and situations to think deep into something which do not fall in your purview or in your capacity of things, you would tend to start thinking in a different pattern. And these are patterns that are not very healthy to our own self because these are actually triggered by external forces. So imagine you're actually traveling to your school and then you kind of see an accident. It might be a small accident, but then the whole day you would be disturbed, isn't it? Why? Because that particular thing was not expected while you were traveling to your school. One. Two is it's not a welcome scene while you're traveling to school. So certain things can actually leave a scar or leave a mark in your psyche, which can propel you to think in a manner that is not very welcome. And then what can you do? There can be conversations which actually tend to pull the other person down. There can be conversations that lead from one fight to another, fight from another, from one bullying to another bullying. So multiple things can trigger factors, might trigger reasoning in your psyche that would, I mean, I wouldn't say encourage, push you into thinking or getting into negative thoughts, which is why I asked you what thoughts are coming to you. Because for every thought, for every thing that you are creating in your mind, there can be a background story to it. Vidya?
I was speaking in general, ma'am.
Yeah, so yeah, I understood. So in general, when you're talking, see, if everything is working in your favor, if everything is positive, will you just simply sit like that and think of something bad? Very unlikely. So whatever negativity is running inside a person or whatever insecurities a person develops will always have a background to it. Most of the times will have a background to it or can be because of whatever is happening right then around him or her.
Yes, ma'am.
Two, your age is also an age where you're trying to question a lot of things, where you are bombarded with conflicting ideas. Do not know what is right and wrong. So that also brings confusion in your mind where you start to think more of negative things than positive. So it has got to do slightly with your age too. So over a period of time, when you cross this age, when you're slightly settled in your thinking and your psyche, you would go back to what you've experienced now and start asking, why did I go through it? Maybe because of the confusions and clutter that you have in your mind, because everything is unclear to you right now. So circumstances, your background, your environment, your ecosystem that you fall into, plus whatever is happening around your immediate circle, that can be family, that can be friends, that can be school, can contribute to what you're thinking. And it definitely contributes to what you're thinking and creating in your minds.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. You're welcome.
Yeah, Rishima.
Yes, she was talking about negative thoughts in her mind. Can I have a question from Varsha Nandini?
Good evening, ma'am. Ma'am,
good evening.
How can the young generation be prepared to accept failures and rejections?
Okay, that's a very good question. Okay, now I think especially in Kerala, we are forced to actually focus only on grades and marks, that everyone wants to be on top. Everyone wants an A plus or an A grade. I'm not saying that you shouldn't score marks. I'm not saying that you shouldn't score an A or an A plus. But then how do you also prepare when you do not achieve that A and A plus? Why do you kind of put yourself in a cocoon when things do not work in your favor? So how do you prepare to fail? And that's a big question. So what do you do when you're preparing for something? You always have a plan B. Got it? And the power of plan B is something that you need to kind of grow up with. whenever things do not work in your favor, there should always be a plan B that you will fall back on. Now, you're traveling to your examination center. The car you were traveling in gets punctured. Will you just stand there and cry?
No.
So I don't think I can write my exam. I might not reach the exam on time. So n number of questions come to you. So what is the next best option? So while you're preparing for your examination or when you're starting from your home, you have to foresee all these other situations that you might not foresee on a normal day. If things are that important on that particular day, or if your target is that important, then you should have a plan B. Now, people aiming for civil service, I know a lot of my friends, a lot of my students who have written civil service at least 4 times by now. Have they given up? No. If they had given up after the first attempt, will they go for the second attempt? No. So you need to, whenever you prepare for something, you need to always think of a plan B and aim for that, so that if you get plan A, it is always a bonus. And if you fail, the world is not going to end. That is something that you need to tell your parents too and your teachers too. Now, teachers are here listening to me. So when once you fail, things are not going to end. You might try harder the next time. You might analyze what happened then in a more productive manner. You might ask yourself certain questions where you will realize where your strengths are, where your weaknesses are. And then you might be able to redefine yourself in a better manner. So please, I want all the children who are listening to me to get this point very clear in your head, that life is a mix of failures and success. And failures might be more. Now, if you ask me about my life, I have had more downs than ups in life. If I had given up then, I wouldn't have reached anywhere. So like how success to you, failures also is a part of your life. And you have to understand that. We listen to a lot of stories. We read a lot of news where children take their lives if they fail in an examination, if they do not get what they want, if they do not get what they wished for. Is that the only way? No. Redefine your priorities. Redefine yourself in your thinking. So if I get only 40 marks this time, aim for the. So accountancy is one subject I really cannot relate to, really can't relate to. In MBA, I flunked, royally. Probably the first time I flunked in my life. But then I thought to myself, okay, this is something I really can't, because numbers beyond 10, I still have to use my fingers. So the next time I thought where my strengths lie, maybe I might be able to address or answer one part of the question paper more accurately. So let me focus on that, so that I get pass marks. So the next time I attended, I came out with 70 marks, which I am still astonished how I got through. But then I think whatever I couldn't do, I kind of neglected it. And whatever I can do, I focused on that. Now, there are certain things in us, you can't push yourself beyond a point, because you have certain capabilities, you have certain strengths. Everyone is not gifted with the same strength and patterns, isn't it? So you need to identify what you are best at. Just because my neighbor is doing that, just because my best friend is doing it, you may not be able to do it. So what is your strength? You identify that and then strive for it. So in that, road to success, you might fall 10 times. That's okay. You will learn to get up and then finish the race. You need to get up. And when you get up, you should have a smile on your face.
Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Let me ask Arvind Anil to put his question. Arvind Anil, shift to. Arvind Anil, can you hear me? Can you put the question now?
Yeah, let's move.
I'll move on to Abhilash. Abhilash Nambudri.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, yes. Ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, my question is, how can people who are actually socially isolated from others including people who are old, can handle this lockdown period when everyone else is not with them?
Beena ma'am and I have been discussing this for some months now. And this is not something that I as a person, you as a person, ma'am as a person can do individually. This has to come from a societal change, from a structure where stakeholders from different departments, from different sections of the society come together and then create a forum where we reach out and help them. So there are pockets, there are terrains where it's very difficult for people to move about, move around, isn't it? And we know that there are many families living there and they're completely cut off from the outside world, especially during this pandemic, because there is 144 declared in Kerala. There are times when everything is under lockdown. So what can we do as a society? Now, these are times when we need to step up, when we need to go beyond our call of duty and then understand that there are people who are less blessed and fortunate than us. So this is not something that we
We're sorry. Individually. You have reached a number that has been disconnected or is no longer in service. If you feel you have reached this recording in error, please check the number and try your call again. We're sorry. You have reached a number that has been disconnected or is no longer in service. If you feel you have reached this recording in error, please check the number and try your call again.
Yes, somebody is...
Please, everyone, mute their audio. I think even including Faisal sir and
I'm just trying it.
All
Faisal sir, you can mute.
Yeah, I'm just doing it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Please carry on, ma'am.
Yes, please.
Yeah. So, did we lose him? No,
Abhilash is here, ma'am.
Abhilash is here. Right. Abhilash, so now, is there any other manner that you have thought of where children can reach out to older generation, senior citizens? See, what is the most pleasurable thing that senior citizens would enjoy? Spending time with children, isn't it? I mean, we know how our grandparents would love to have us around them. So is there a system where we can create a network where at least 10 people from one area would be taken to older generation, where we have a library set up, where we have an evening where we call them together and spend some productive time with them, cracking jokes, telling them what is happening, sharing stories from your own life. So this involves huge networking. This involves people from every strata of society to come together. Now, I would request Beena ma'am's inputs in this, because this is not something that you or I can facilitate individually.
Actually, what we can do is we can form some groups. Even in your school group, you can, senior citizens or your parents, grandparents, you can engage somebody. I remember one experience in Thrissur, one school, one of my friend is a principal there. But before, not during COVID days, before that she was doing something like she asked the children to find out whoever is staying alone in that panchayat. So each child in the, from her school adopt one grandmother, like all the ladies in the single ladies in that panchayat, and these children will go there, talk with them, chat with them, they will help them like that. Then suddenly the children and the old ladies, they became good friends, so their mental tension and all those things were lessened like that. So with this medium, like this online medium, if Abhilash can find somebody in your class or some old people in the locality, and if you can talk half an hour or 10 minutes, you can call that person and talk to he or she'll be happy or he'll be happy. Like that, we have to do something like that. That is, it's my suddenly I thought like that and I'm telling you. Aparna.
Yeah,
I think some buddy system, like no buddy system, not buddy system should not be peer group like that. No, it can no, we can go to elder people also like that. We can do something.
Absolutely, this is exactly what I was coming to tell, that I think schools should initiate a process where they identify students who are compassionate and who can connect with older generation very well, where they kind of have an everyday conversation or an alternate day conversation with them, so that they also look forward to that call or spending that time over a call with the child.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Arshida Unnikrishnan.
Ma'am?
Arshida, can you hear me? Yes, please put your question, Arshida.
Good evening, ma'am.
Yes.
My question is, what can children do to improve the mental health of the rest of the family members?
Yeah, so now as understanding children, now when you ask the question, you said what children can do. So you need to be as understanding as any other adult, because whatever mental stress and uncertainties you are facing as a child, probably adults are facing or going through it 10 times bigger and higher. Now, if you can understand that, that is the biggest help that you can give to your adults first. Two is, this is also the time that you are cut off from your peers, your friends. So there could be a lot of stress that you invariably might transfer unknowingly to your parents and elders in the household. I can see you smile. So then I know that what I'm trying to convey is a fact. So keep aside some of your interests, some of what you have wished for a while. I'm not asking you to kind of delete it forever, but park it aside for some time and then involve yourself in everyday chores at home. Bring down the physical, emotional, mental burden of your parents, grandparents, whoever is living with you. Now, why are they going through such stress? Because now if there are four people in the house, I know I get so many calls. If there are four people in the house, there are four different interests in food, four different interests in what they want to watch that particular day on TV. So then there is this conflict unknowingly creeping in elders in the family. So there are many things that as children you can start to introduce as a lifestyle mechanism to. Harshida, are you with me here?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so and then how many of you actually ask your mother or father, how are you feeling today? It not necessarily need to come from only your parents. You can also do the same to them. So when they are overburdened, go give them a hug and ask them what happened. The more you converse to them, the more they would open up. I am a parent too. And I have a boy who is in the 10th grade. So I can completely understand the question and relate to it. So every day we have these conversations at home. So when I see his face change, I go, I hug him, I ask him, what happened? Same thing he does to me when I have a bad call, when I have a situation where I find it difficult to handle. He comes and asks, what happened, Amma? So be truthful to them. Sit down, have a conversation. Just because I'm a mother, just because my age group is different, I don't have to put up a face, a mask, and then create stories and then tell him. Just be very frank as to what is happening, because then you are also in an age where you understand what is happening around you, the social, the political, the economic crisis that the country is going through. So some sort of dialogue at home, open, transparent dialogue at home, helps in the mental, emotional stability of everyone in that household. Arshida, I hope I have answered you.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Arshida, I hope you practice what exactly you have heard. If not, you are not doing it now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not only Arshida, all of them can do that. No?
Everyone who's listening, at least after this call, go back to your mothers, give them a hug to your fathers, give them a hug to your brothers, ask them, how are you feeling? And then it has to come from your heart. Just because Aparna said, don't do that.
Okay. Let me ask Deepthi to come forward. Deepthi, you can ask your question.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
Ma'am, currently for nearly 6 or 7 months, we are locked up in our houses. So this will continue on for another 6 months or so. But one day we will go back to our school. So what will be the impact on children when we go back to our schools? Will it be a positive one or a negative one, like the mindset of children?
I would say emotionally, mentally, what we have been listening to, what we've been addressing, I'm sure people would wholeheartedly welcome the school, the physical space, because every person we interact with, every child like you we talk to, they're just wanting to go back to their schools. So I think mentally, emotionally, you will be much more happier, healthier. But physically, it might take a toll because of late, you've been like completely shut down. Your physical movement is completely affected. So if we know that one fine morning, the schools are going to be opened, then there is some sort of exercise that you need to do physically to get there, which is why it would be a staggered opening of physical spaces too. One fine morning, you will not be asked to go to school 7 days or 5 days a week. So the people who are at the decision-making levels also know that you have gone through something that we never expected a child would go through, which is why there are times when you will have to sit down and prepare yourself physically to that change. So some sort of exercises that way will help you tide over this. But I'm sure, I would say majority of the children would just be so happy to go back to your schools and spaces. Aren't you looking forward to it?
Yes, ma'am.
So that's the answer. As teachers, I'm sure teachers would want to just hug their children rather than meet them virtually every day.
Right. But I think the question can be better framed like, how should you prepare yourself mentally before you start going to school?
Okay.
After now, the lockdown, what are the preparations?
Yeah. So I think
that was a question that was
now, what is missing now is a structure and discipline for children. Right. Now, I don't think you stick to a wake up time and a sleep time. I don't think we stick to a timetable. I mean, whatever it be, physical activity, mental. What we need to do is, I think as parents and teachers, when you know that physical space is not far ahead, we will have to kind of put some systems and practices so that they kind of start following it. Now, and then it is also a time when they might go through withdrawal symptoms because then they are completely cut off from virtual world altogether. Now, all this while we told them, do not sit in front of the TV for too long, do not sit in front of the screens for too long. And then we've been like forcing them to sit in front of the TVs, in front of the systems for too long now, all these last 6 months. Now we're taking that luxury again from them. We're snatching it away from them again. So people who've been like constantly in touch with their friends who are not from the same school, now cousins who are not in the same school or in the same physical space, they will find it difficult mentally. Because then there is a period that they will be away from their phones. And that is something that we will have to deal with. That is going to actually affect children. And we will have to kind of have limit setting from now till when the schools open so that they get accustomed to kind of getting away from their screens and their personal time with their friends and cousins on a regular and a frequent space. I mean, I'm sure they're like 24/7 connected now, if I'm not wrong.
Yes, yes.
Yes. This is a frequent question we get in our online classes. Now, what will happen when we go back to school?
No, it is a question that needs intervention, that needs a lot of serious thought into it as to how are we going to handle this. Because as adults, we know if we keep our phone away for 2 to 3 hours and then get, immerse ourselves into something, there are times when we would be like, we really want to be in touch with the world then. So imagine the children going back to schools and then being away from their phones for eight hours at one stretch. How are they going to handle it?
Right.
Yeah. So we will have to find systems for it.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Let me ask Arvind to come in. Arvind, can you hear me? Arvind Anil, can you hear me? Anjuma? Anjuma, you may ask your question. Yes, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, my question is, loss of identity. During this period, children feel loss of identity, who tends to overachieve in academically, in sports and extracurriculars. These children may feel deep sadness as if they are losing a part of who they are. Ma'am, how can we resolve it?
To begin with, let me tell you now, yes, as much as your work, your passion and whatever your achievements are that become a part of your identity or you believe is your identity, you should also understand that what you are presently is what you should be. Your identity should be what you are that particular day. It shouldn't. Now, Sachin Tendulkar, we all know that we relate him to cricket. Now, did he lose his identity after he retired from cricket or after he stopped playing cricket? So as a person, you have a certain identity and individuality. Now, if you kind of relate 101% of your achievements or your work and your passion to what your identity is, then it's going to be a struggle. Now, yes, I love my work. Socio is my bread and butter. I whatever I do is like passionately done and carried out. But tomorrow, if Socio is not there, then if I feel that my identity is lost, then I haven't built myself as a person. So children, now I understand there is no competition now, and a lot of children find pleasure in getting that first prize and second prize on the podium and then find pleasure in that. There is absolutely no wrong with that. But if you feel that that defines you as a person, then you need to rethink. So have your own, I mean, passion, have your success points, your points where you feel elated, where you feel not so elated, all that is fine. But as a person, you need to define yourself. What am I? So children who are listening to me or listening to us now who are into sports, please don't feel that you have lost yourself in the last 6 or 7 months. The world is still going to come back to what it used to be, not probably in the same dynamics, but definitely we are going back to physical spaces. But that shouldn't affect your current thinking of who am I now? What happened to my identity? No. I know, I mean, this is a very valid question because we receive a lot of calls where people have lost their jobs and then in turn they feel that they have lost their identity. So somewhere you need to start to identify and accept yourself first as a person with likes, dislikes, with ups and downs, with success and defeats. And then you work towards redefining, if not this, what else can I do? Now, sports people can identify or log into, there are n number of platforms where you can make yourself physically fit, where you can join a half an hour program and then work out at home or do whatever physical activity you can inside your permitted landscape. And then you keep yourself fit. So if you're not being able to perform in an outdoor space, at least keep your body fit enough so that when you go back, you achieve what you have lost. Anjima? And culturally, I think if people who, there are people who are singing, dancing, I don't think they have had to stop. Their opportunities have only doubled now, I would say. Because you don't need an open stage or a theater to perform now. If you have a room and a phone, the world is watching you.
Yeah.
Yeah, even the fitness, I think all the students, all the children, you know, everyone can do this, you know, YouTube and all those, very, you know, many programs are there, the aerobics are there, walking programs are there in the small space. Yeah, they can do the, all the children can do that.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Anjuma is an upcoming photographer, ma'am. So that question, right.
Very good. So this is the right time for you, Anjuma.
Yeah. Right. Okay. So
you could start you could start an Instagram page. You can tell the world what your interests are. So let's not only look at only the negative side of this pandemic. The pandemic has also given a lot of positives to our interests, passions, to what we can do, to what extent can we stretch ourselves to.
Anjima, where is the? She's not there, I think.
Yeah, she's
okay.
No, ma'am, I'm
left. Okay.
Yeah, we can't see you.
Right, she's there.
Yes.
Shall I pass on to Meghna? Yeah. Meghna Anu.
Yes, ma'am.
You can put your question, Meghna.
Ma'am, can you see me?
No.
No.
Now?
No, never mind. Please. Okay.
Yeah, you're there.
Ma'am, my question's already been answered, but I have another question.
Yeah.
Okay.
A few days ago, I wanted to play an online game with my friends, but my mother said I shouldn't do it. So how do I like talk to my parents? Because every time I tell a joke, she tells me that this joke is really bad. It's a serious topic. Stop laughing. My mother is sitting here. She says that this joke is really bad. You shouldn't talk about death and stuff like that. So how can I appeal to my parents and possibly brainwash them?
Allowing you to
brilliant question.
So now one thing is, Meghna, let's not brainwash parents. Let's make them understand. Okay, now brainwashing, you can possibly do and then get away with it once. Now if you make them understand, then you're there to gain. I mean, for whatever times it I mean, you need to make them understand. So one is, see, why are parents restricting use of phones or not wanting you to get into online gaming is because of whatever we read, face, and know what is happening behind the cyber world. So that is one. Two is, now I really, really do not know what dirty jokes you're cracking. So for me to actually shoot in the dark is very difficult. But then if you feel that it is hurting somebody's sentiments, then you need to kind of ask yourself whether I need to actually go ahead with this joke or not. Now, jokes per se is good, but unless it hurts someone. Now, if you know that it is hurting someone's sentiments, you never know what your mother is attaching that joke with or what memories are flushing into her when you are cracking that joke. So ask her, how is it affecting her? Rather than brainwashing, try a conversation as to why do you think that this joke, you feel that this joke is not apt. I can see your mom behind you. So I wouldn't mind if your mom wants to answer this and address this, if it can actually solve the problem. Now, talking about death is not a wrong thing. I think we all should encourage people to talk about death, because we don't have enough conversations around death these days. And people just shy away from talking about death, which is why we have dialogues about death and peaceful dying and things like that now, which are opened up. So if it is just about death, then I think we need to have a better conversation with your parents. But if it is something that is affecting their sentiments, then you need to ask how and why, so that you also know where it is coming from. You might not do the same mistake with another person after that. Meghna, you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So will you go back and ask your mom?
Yeah. We'll have a conversation.
Yes, you need to have a conversation. Don't try brainwashing your parents, okay?
By brainwashing, I actually meant how to make her understand what I'm saying.
Understood. I understood it.
She's not familiar with those words. Like, okay. TTY, I'll talk to you later. She thinks it's a bad word, but it's actually a short form that I used to text with.
Now, Meghna, we all fall into a different generation. I didn't know that TTYL was talk to you later until you told me now. So, I mean, you can't assume that your parents also know all these things. So you need to be patient enough. Why don't you transfer some of the knowledge that you have to your parents too? So it makes things easier. It has to be a give and take at home, isn't it?
Yeah, right.
Okay.
That's a good answer.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Thank you, Meghna. May I ask Nimmi ma'am to come forward to put questions? Nimmi ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay, right.
Ma'am. Okay, thank you, Jashmi, ma'am. Now, may I call upon Meera? Meera, are you there with your question?
Yes, ma'am.
Meera of 12th. Yeah.
Yeah.
Good evening, ma'am. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Yes, ma'am. My question is that one of my friends suffers from a very low self-esteem. And so in this pandemic situation, when I can't talk to her face-to-face, how can I do my best to help her and support her?
Why are you not able to talk to her face-to-face?
Ma'am, because of the pandemic, I can't go over.
So that's not face-to-face. It's physically not being able to be there for her is what you meant, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. But then are you having a conversation every day with her?
Yes, ma'am.
And is it over a video call?
No, ma'am. We don't really have time for that.
Why?
Ma'am, we are in 12th, so...
Okay. So then, I understand. I mean, I know your teachers are here. I know your principal is watching. I know a lot of the teachers are watching. But as much as studies are important or lessons are important, I think relationships are also important. So, I mean, finding 10 minutes of your time from your 24-hour day shouldn't be an issue at all. If you think that that person matters to you, I mean, every person matters to you, but then her mental health, her self-esteem, if you feel that you are one person who can actually contribute to her well-being, you should find that time for her.
Yes,
ma'am. Which is why Beena ma'am and I have been discussing about a buddy system, where you become a buddy to a person or another person becomes a buddy to you, where you share everything which in normal circumstances you might not want to share with your parents or your siblings. And what does that buddy do to you? Now she is your shoulder to lean on to. Now if you go through a problem and if your friend says that, no, I don't have the time, is that the way that we would want to look at life?
No, ma'am.
No. So please find that time. And if you really feel that you're overburdened with studies, write a mail to your class teacher saying that, ma'am, as studies are important, my friend is also equally important. And I think teachers should also be with you, not just with you, with children who are going through such stress and low self-esteem. I mean, the purpose of education is not just owning marks. It is also to help another person be compassionate and be there for them. It's not just be telling yourself in your head that I am kind, compassionate. These are times that you need to actually show it in your action. So take 10 minutes of time, do that video call with her every day, make her smile and then keep the phone down. Now, every day she might not smile because a person going through low self-esteem, it's very difficult for them to actually even smile. So every day you might not be able to do that, but if you don't do a video call 7 days a week, 5 days a week, you do 2 days, she smiles, you've done your best.
Okay, ma'am.
Got it?
I will do that.
Please.
Yes, ma'am.
You have a beautiful
smile. Thank you, ma'am.
I mean, I'm sure people watching you would definitely smile.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Meera. Abhirami from class 12th. Abhirami, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, come on.
Good morning. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good evening.
Yeah, good evening, ma'am. So, this is my question. In this pandemic period, children are restricted from going outside to play. Due to this, children are introduced to new games and are trapped in a vicious circle called addiction, which the child itself is not aware of. These cause an aggression in children and a change in their social behavior. So what are the measures we can take to reduce this addiction in children towards virtual games?
So you know that you are getting addicted, right?
Not me.
So this was a question in general. Okay, now this has to be answered from the ecosystem a child falls into. Now there is something called limit setting that we actually encourage parents to do and even teachers to during the pandemic, where you restrict screen time of each child. And then if you are a child who do not know the pros and cons of being online for a longer period, then you need to take a course which talks to you, which educates you on cyber threats, cyber bullying, what all threats are looming in cyberspace without your knowledge, with your knowledge and stuff. So I think, I don't know whether your school is already doing that, but essentially every school should run, I would say, one program every 2 or 3 months not during the pandemic. Now with pandemic, I think every month you can run a 1 hour program on cybersecurity and safety measures that a child and parents can also take, so that you don't fall deep into it without your knowledge or unconsciously. Now, when you know that you are getting addicted to your screen space, now we had come out with a campaign called Together We Can. And Abhirami, Together We Can is which talks about one, cyber use, overburdened with cyber use, fatigue because of cyber use, and how do we cut ourselves from that and then become fresh after a while is the campaign all about. So it talks about whenever you feel overburdened, just shut yourself down from the screen space immediately without giving a second thought. And I'm sure every person has one or two interests. It could be listening to music, it could be just sitting down with a coffee or tea, or just going to your mother and father and talking to them about the day. But don't think whether I should do it or not. That cut off from that cyberspace should happen ASAP, the minute you feel that I am overburdened with screen time. So find alternatives. And now what we've been watching and listening to in this last 4 or 5 months is that children, when they're overburdened with their school lessons, they switch to social media.
Yes.
And when they are overburdened with social media, they would switch to online gaming. And then there are times when parents have called up and then told us that the child has a posture issue because 8 hours he's been sitting like that, moving from one platform to another platform to another platform. And when the parent goes and calls him is when he realizes that he can't move his head. And that's a very dangerous trend. So which is why we always tell there should be a limit setting. I'm not forcing parents to kind of be there, pounce on the children and then force limits on them. But make them take breaks in between, physical breaks in between. Walk, change your posture, do some bit of stretching. Because then there are times when the food is served onto your learning desk because you don't take a break. So you're not moving around even for that. So I'm telling you, like we discussed this issue before, more than mental issues, you will have physical issues now. Movement issues now. Body aches going up. So if you know your sibling is overburdened and addicted to cyberspace, don't go knock on his head or her head and then scream at him or her. Just tell them, take a break. Half an hour you sit, 1 hour you sit, take a break for 5 minutes, then you go back to the screen. Now that 5 minutes, if they are enjoying the break, then I'm sure they will prolong it for some more time. So gradually introduce the breaks into your cyber time.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome.
Okay. Next question is from Arsha of class 12B. Arsha.
Good evening, ma'am.
Yes. Good evening. You can post your question. Yes.
Yes, ma'am. So nowadays, most of the time, we are confined within our digital world. So we are less socializing with our teachers, our friends in person. So whether this will create a negative impact in our behavior, such as social retardness or symptoms of fright. Because whenever we open the TV or whenever we are reading newspaper, we are seeing that the number of crimes being committed has dramatically increased. Particularly the youth. So how we can overcome this situation?
Now, when you ask me crime, are you talking about cyber crimes or physical crimes?
Ma'am, everything, whether it is cyber bullying, domestic violence or murders, everything has dramatically increased. So particularly the youth committing crimes. So how we can overcome
I that? I understood. See, there are a lot of studies. Now, I was discussing this with Beena ma'am. A lot of the things we are yet to kind of come to a conclusive study because this is in transition now. Now, we thought schools will open up in September, which didn't happen. The second date that they gave was October 15th, which didn't happen. So a lot of the things are still very uncertain to all of us. And in this dark phase, I would say a lot of the youth are also taking advantage of the disabilities that we are going through. So, yesterday we were having a chat with the cybersecurity team who sits in Pune. Now they said threefold the number of crimes have gone up on cyber world during the pandemic, because everyone is hooked to the screens and phones and tablets. So now these are not in our hand. What can we do? We can only have awareness campaigns, talks on a daily basis, so that people know what they are getting into. People know where the threats are looming large. So schools, parents, public spaces, public as a community have a large role to play in this, in curbing a lot of things and also making our society safe socially and cyber-wise. But if you ask me for a solution to it, I think we can only educate our community, our immediate people, and our children. But if every household, every community, every school starts doing that, that itself will create a larger change and larger, safer community socially. Because I don't think any school was prepared to handle this when this the pandemic struck, isn't it? I mean, Faisal, sir, correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, you're right. You said it right.
We all kind of learned it through the pandemic. We put systems and practices in place through the pandemic, and it all happened through a lot of error methods.
Yeah,
so there is no right or wrong to it. We all are, traveling. That is what children also need to understand. We all are traveling in this together. We are not, exceptional, or we don't have any other extra blessings on us. We all are traveling in this together.
Yeah, we too are learning. Yeah. That's it.
Absolutely. I mean, a lot of the teachers are not even comfortable with technology. What are we saying? What are we talking about then?
Yeah.
Now, we all are blessed because we know technology. I mean, at least KV students are able to access their classes now. Like one of the students said, there are a lot of students who are totally cut off from reality. I mean, totally cut off from the outside world.
Yeah, that's true.
So we all are in this together. We are trying to find means and ways to address this, at least in a manner that not many people are left out.
Definitely.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Asha. The next with the query is Rituparna from class 12E. Rituparna, are you there?
Good evening.
Yes, good evening. Rituparna, you can go ahead with your question.
Ma'am, I wanted to ask, like friends reach out to each other when they are feeling a bit depressed, or they're feeling anxiety, or they're feeling a bit overwhelmed, or they're feeling a bit sad about something, and they reach out. So I want to know, like, how do we respond to them without it sounding that we are slighting their problems, or that we are not being, without really sounding as flat? I don't know, like, how do we act, like, respond so that they feel good about, better about themselves again?
Okay, so now this is a very, it's a loose end question. So for me, unless I know what the issue is, for me to actually answer this question is difficult. But what I would tell you is, one is, if a person calls you and tells that she or he is going through a problem, listen to them without interrupting. First and foremost, don't judge them. Second. Oh, okay. Before finishing, you would say, okay, this is why it happened to you. Now here you are judging them. So don't judge them. Listen to them completely. Reiterate what they are trying to say. Oh, okay, you were saying this. So then the other person knows that, okay, I'm listening to her. Now, who asked me this question? I can't see her online.
Rituparna.
Now a person, I'm giving you a live example. Now, Aparna calls Rituparna. Aparna has an issue, okay? So Rituparna is on the other side. Now, you just give cues to make Aparna understand or feel that you are listening to her. First point, okay? Now, when I am talking, when you are giving me cues, you also repeat whatever she is saying. Okay, Aparna, so you were telling me this, which gives Aparna the confidence that this is somebody who I can call when I have a problem, because she is listening to me attentively. Then do not say, oh, Aparna, this happened to you, because you know what? Now that is where you're starting to judge the other person. So then if Aparna is me, then I would ask myself, why did I call her if she is there to judge me? So making that person comfortable with you is the first step, listening to him or her without judging them. Second, do not give solutions if you do not know what the issue is properly. Try this. No, you are not an expert in that field, so don't give solutions. If you feel that it needs a third party intervention, tell them, why don't you talk to a teacher? Why don't you talk to a friend? A person who is elder to you, a friend who can assist you or guide you in the right manner. Or to your parents. Now encourage them to open up to the parents, and that should be the first thing that you should be doing. Now, if after all this it is not working out, tell her, you can see, I am sure every school has a psychologist on board.
Yeah.
Ask them to reach out or mail them. And if these are issues that people come to you where you think you can handle it, and these are small issues that you can handle it from your end, with whatever knowledge you have, tell them that you are there to support. And if it is not, something that is very serious and out of the way, be there with them, for them. And tell them reassurance. Now, when you keep the phone down, there is a reassurance that you need to give them. Tomorrow you have a problem, or tonight you have a problem, please call me. Now, that is where you start building confidence in another person. Now, you listen to, Ada, somebody is calling, let me keep the phone down. You keep the phone down, the person will not reach out to you again. Because you have not finished that concern and given due importance to that call. So, do you have anything more to talk? Can I keep the phone down? Now, these are small, small things that create bigger and deeper bonds. Rituparna, got it?
Yes, ma'am. I ask this because whenever someone comes with a problem, I feel that I have to solve it. That's why they're coming to me. So, but I don't know what the answer is.
No. People do not always come to you for solutions. Rituparna, that is something. Now, children, whoever is here today and listening to us, please understand that people reach out to you not always for solutions. They just want someone to listen to you. They need a bouncing board. They need to just relieve that stress from them emotionally and mentally. So all you need to do is just listen to them attentively.
Yeah.
Got it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, Rituparna. Next online is Neha. Neha E from class 12D.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am. Yes.
Good evening.
Okay, so we were talking about the negative impacts of this COVID-19 and lockdown. So my question is, had this situation of sitting inside our homes inhibited any pro-social behavior or good qualities in children?
Actually, we have just started studies. I think world over, people have started studies. Organizations like WHO, UNESCO have started studies on that. But then, yeah, a lot of pro-social behavior, lot of bonding that happened during the pandemic. This was also the time lot of families came together as a whole unit. And then, I'm a living example. After having married for so many years, this was the first time I was being in the same space with my partner and my son, the longest. So you kind of evolve through that process, understand each other better. And then this is a social evolution, right? I mean, in your own space, if you're trying your best to understand and then be giving in and then be kind and compassionate to the other person, that itself is a social evolution. So that way, yes, the pandemic has thrown open a lot of opportunities for people to spend quality time with each other. And I think the highlight of this pandemic has been that whoever we lost in the process, friends, cousins, who we never got in touch with earlier, we all have come together as a community, as a family. Every day there are calls happening. Every week there are Zoom calls and conference calls happening between one school group, another college group, family groups. So this has brought families together as one. And that is one good part of social evolution.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, Neha.
Thank you, Neha. Gautam of class 12D. Gautam? Gautam, are you there?
I would like to have some questions from boys too.
Yeah, that's what. Gautam? Passing on. Next is Sneha Gomathi of class 12D. Sneha Gomathi.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening. Carry on. Yeah, good evening.
Ma'am, my question is, I think there is a kind of lack of personal space at home nowadays. How to really handle it?
Okay, now. Yeah, I think this dialogue we need to have in every household, that I'm writing a column now on, the changes, the periodic changes that we need to redefine in our own household and homes, in which I've emphasized this factor that we need to start treating our children as another individual who needs as much space as us. And I know that it's very difficult to make parents understand that, because parents eventually would ask, why do they need space? I mean, what is it that they would do within their space? I mean, it's a formative years of a child. I mean, formative years, you have gone beyond that formative years, yet you're still forming your identity. You're still forming your expressions and thoughts. So you need your space. Now, children especially need their space, be it at home or be it in schools. So I think schools should initiate small counseling sessions for parents where they are not on top of them, piloting them every day. Now, you can't become pilot parents to children during the pandemic. You need to give them their space to talk, to express, to invent, to reinvent, to make mistakes, come out of it, understand it themselves. Now, if you curb them, then this pandemic is going to affect them, I mean, way beyond what we can fathom. So who asked this question? Sneha. Sneha, do you have conversations with your mother and father at home, whoever your guardians are?
Yes, ma'am.
You do have. Have yes, you felt a lack of personal space at home?
Yes, like I am most of the time surrounded by my family members nowadays.
Mm. I don't know. In the sense, is it physically surrounded by them, or I mean, can you elaborate it a bit more?
We all family members are now at home only, so. Earlier, at least I used to go to school. Parents used to go to office.
Okay.
But now we're all at home, and we have to cooperate with each other more nowadays.
Absolutely. I completely buy that. But then you should also, children, you should tell your parents that as individuals, you also need your space every day. Be it half an hour to just sit and think about whatever you like the most, to just dream. Don't do anything but sit and dream. I mean, dreams make you what you are or who you are. So tell your parents that as much as you need your space, we need our space too. Make them understand that, because tell them you're not going out. You are not being with your peer group. You're not being with your favorite teacher or teachers. And you're just confined to that physical space. So there is some venting mechanism that you need. So teachers, Faisal sir, I think if children are not getting their me time, what we call as me time, I think you should encourage them to have that me time every day where they introspect a lot of things, talk to themselves.
Yeah.
I do a lot of talking to myself. So just talk. People would say that you are mad. That's okay. Absolutely fine.
Yeah, exactly.
But just talk to yourself.
That's a good idea. Yeah.
Yeah.
So anyway, teachers do a lot of things. Okay, yeah. Just like we are giving during online sessions also, we are giving enough time to interact with each other, just like that.
So Faisal said, the thing is now we are, the communication has just gone multiple fold in terms of how we are as a society and as social beings. So there are times we would just want to shut down and be in our space just to be with ourselves.
Yeah.
You should also encourage that. That is one way of getting them mentally fit.
Mm-hmm.
Away from everything and just be with themselves for some time, at least every day.
Yeah, exactly.
I think suffices.
Expecting more questions?
Nimi ma'am?
More questions?
Yes, sir. There are a few more students online.
Yeah,
almost 10 to 12 are there. Can I go ahead or should we wind it up here?
Can we take two more questions and then wind up?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so is it like, should I call the name or anyone
no, random,
who's like feeling,
I mean,
yeah, that would be better. Let the children come forward.
Ma'am?
Yes.
Yes.
Ma'am, my name is Nikhilesh. I am in class 10th.
Okay.
So, ma'am, like you earlier told that we always need someone to bounce our anxieties upon. And that means we are parents, like we need some special friends to whom we can talk privately, personally. So how do we convince our parents to give us that time to regularly contact with them, and especially if they are of the opposite gender?
This is a very good question, because generally, I think in Kerala especially, we have this moral policing coming into picture where a boy is not allowed to be friends with a girl. And this is a very, very dangerous trend. Now, I would always encourage girls to have a friend and a boy, and a boy to have a friend and a girl, because they understand the dynamics better. Now, each time you have a friend from an opposite sex doesn't mean that you are going to marry and then settle with that person. I mean, why do we always think linear? So, I am sure parents are listening to this conversation. So this question should go well with all the parents. Please encourage your child to build healthy relationships with people from opposite gender. And that is the only way they would respect gender, the opposite gender. And also, I have seen a lot of my children share their hormonal changes with the opposite gender. So it is, in a way, a boy understanding the hormonal changes in a girl, and he would start respecting the gender more. It is the same, I mean, it is vice versa. So you kind of feel more open and comfortable to talk to opposite gender, because between girls, you always feel that the person might judge you. The person might not like what you say. So there are many things gender-wise you have inside your head. Now, with an opposite sex, you always feel that space to open up, and parents should encourage that. The more you encourage that, the more they would become, I would say, rounded individuals. Who asked this question?
Nikhilesh
Joshi. Play this video back to your parents. They will listen to this.
Thank you, ma'am.
From the student's side. Yeah. Aditya, you can. Aditya.
Ma'am, recently.
Zia, please wait.
Ma'am. Yes.
Ma'am, recently I came across an article which was saying that around 70% has increased by the number of people going for plastic surgery. And it was showing the reason that it was due to this present online classes, every time seeing through their faces in live. So if we come across this type of situation, what should we do?
You come across situations like that, mean are you looking to have a
not me
surgery?
other people.
So see, this is not a latest trend. It is just stemming from one basic insecurity that my looks define me. Now, as a society, we lay so much of importance and stress on looks rather than the behavior or the compassion or kindness in a person. Now, that is just, I mean, a lot of the companies have made use of this pandemic to promote that. Promote what? Your insecurities.
Yes.
Now, why did Fair and Lovely take out the name Lovely from it? Because there was this movement that said that, I mean, lovely, being loved and lovely as a person can mean many things, not just your skin complexion. So this pandemic, I am sure a lot of consumer-based product companies have cashed in on this opportunity to make money. And that is why this plastic surgery is going up. Because somebody would say that you don't look good on screen. So tell these people that does not define you. If you do not have a good heart, how much ever plastic surgery you do to yourself and make your face good, is it going to help in the long run? No. So that's the answer.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. So,
ma'am.
Yeah. One more question, last, okay?
Ma'am.
Yes.
Yes.
Good evening.
Yes.
My name is Shriya and I'm from class 10th. And ma'am, my question to you is that what is the most effective way to manage anxiety? Because I feel quite anxious, and since I'm in class 10, the thought of exams only gets me quite worked up and it gets me quite anxious. And this anxiety always leads to overthinking.
Okay. Now, Hridya, stay online, okay? I have a few more questions to you. Is there is this anxiety solving your exam papers?
No, ma'am.
No. Is this anxiety helping you solve the exam papers?
Ma'am, sometimes it does, because like when I feel anxious, I kind of work harder just not to see the worst outcome. So it is kind of helping me, but not the best way.
What is the worst outcome? Tell me that first.
Ma'am, I always think that the worst outcome will be me flunking on a subject so hard and like being humiliated.
Who will humiliate you? Like, Shreya, if you have listened to this conversation, the first question that we address is, how do we accept failures as much as we accept success? So there is no and humiliation is a deep word, Shreya. Okay. So even if you flunk in a subject, you should be as lighthearted to take in that. So the thought of this humiliation is what is driving your anxiety. So the maximum what is going to happen, I will flunk. Okay, let me be. Two times you tell that to yourself, your anxiety will come down. So you're building your anxiety yourself on a thought that might or might not happen, and something that is irrelevant to your existence. You will still live a beautiful life whether you flunk or not flunk. Got it, Shreya?
Shreya?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah,
so you do your best. So efforts matter, not grades and marks. That is another tagline that together we can came out with, and especially for children like you. You put in your best effort, best foot forward, and then you just leave it. If you can, if that yields the results, well and good. If not, you can try next time. But that is not going to define you. If teachers know that you've put in your best effort, they are also not going to judge you. So the fear that we develop inside us, the main fear is that what will the other person think of me? Everything creeps from this judgment factor.
Exactly.
Yeah. So Shreya, whatever it be, I am like this and I own myself. Nobody owns me. Shreya, got it?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you confident now, even if you flunk?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, all right.
Aparna, ma'am, there was like yet another student who wanted to ask you something. She was here on the line, but because like Aditya was asking, she couldn't attend to the question.
Can I also do something? I mean, just because too many people are wanting to kind of reach out, I will share my number. They can WhatsApp me. They can leave a WhatsApp note. I can, whenever I find time in the next 24 hours, I will listen to each and then give them replies. Because I don't want people to go back feeling that my question was not answered.
But I think Nikita is clear, I think. Nikita,
two more questions I can, yes.
Ma'am, can mental health issues like maybe anxiety or depression affect our physical health, ma'am?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, physical health, money, depression and anxiety actually makes you lethargy driven. It would lead to a stage where you would not want to move out of your bed. It would cut down your, general productivity by like 50%, depending on what stage you are in the depression and anxiety tool. So this eventually can get to a stage where you do not want to come out of that room, where you do not want to physically move around, where you would restrict yourself physically, mentally, emotionally. So eventually it would start your everyday movements. Yes, it does. Which is why when we say that if you're feeling low for more than, let's say, 15 days, if you do not feel energetic enough to do whatever you've been doing with passion, with love, with excitement, if you've not been able to perform them for more than 15 days, you need to reach out to a mental health practitioner. And if you are excessively eating, if you're binge eating for no reason, if you are just wanting to sleep and sleep more, these are early signs. Unexplained fatigue, unexplained tiredness. So these are all reasons where you are mentally shutting down yourself. So early signs, I actually wanted to give them early signs of depression and anxiety before we end the session. So one more question we take, and then I just run through that. Yeah.
Zia George.
Yes, ma'am.
Class 10D, you wanted to ask something to madam?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, as most of the parents are going for work. So the children may be alone or with their grandparents. So sometimes they are not able to manage the children because they are very mischievous and do many naughty things. So how will we control such children?
Now, what age group are we talking about here?
Ma'am, recently there was, recently in my neighbor, ma'am, there were two children, ma'am, there were almost 7 tube lights, ma'am, they damaged, and they were not going to tell that they did so. And they were of fourth class.
See, those are infants. I mean, those are kids. Basically, they just want to have fun. And some children find pleasure in breaking things and being mischievous. And it's all good. I mean, these are all part of your growing up things. So this is a very personal and a domestic matter, which as parents and as a family, they need to find a solution. Maybe have a babysitter at home or an elderly person who can run behind the children. Now, grandparents, you really can't be expecting them to run behind the children. So some sort of plan B or an alternate system in place when the parents are away at work. Now that I really can't intervene because it's a very domestic issue.
And of course, it's the teachers, ma'am. They just cut the wire with the scissors.
Now, if you, I mean, to be very honest, if you think that you can engage them for some time every day and then give them some productive classes, keep them engaged in a productive way where they understand what they are doing, that would be wonderful. Reach out, volunteer.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Can we have your concluding remarks, Aparna?
Yeah, so I really want the children to understand early signs of depression and anxiety because I think we all are talking about mental health here. And every parent and every teacher listening to this conversation should understand that as much as physical health is important and significant in a person's life, mental health too is important and significant. I would say it is more important than physical health because only if you're mentally alert and up and running will it transfer to being you physically fit too. So early signs would be one where you would just feel lethargic for no reason and suddenly lose interest in things, in classes, in series that you are watching, and generally not find pleasure or happiness in anything that you perform. Two is where you would start excessive eating or not eating. You would cut your meals. You would say, no, I'm not hungry. And then it would go on for some days. Three is, You might sleep for 10 hours continuously and yet you might be able to go back to sleep after 2 hours of break. Or there are people who would not sleep continuously for days together. Fourth is irritability. You don't know why you're feeling irritable. You don't know why you're feeling frustrated, but anything and everything irritates you. Somebody asks you a good thing, it also irritates you. So unexplained irritability and frustrations creeping inside you. Insecurity, developing whatever you felt. You were a completely confident person. Suddenly you question your identity. Why am I like this? Why do I not do things the right way? So sudden loss of that self-esteem, self-respect. These are all early signs of depression and anxiety. Now, depression and anxiety, now 50%, studies, research also shows that 50% of symptoms that you exhibit in a person who are depressed would also be seen in a person who are anxious. So it goes hand in hand, not necessarily that everyone who is depressed will have anxiety issues and everyone who is anxious will have depression symptoms, but more or less the symptoms would be the same. And then when it gets to the next level is when we identify it to be properly either depression or anxiety that is keeping the person largely not feeling mentally all right. So reach out to a mental health practitioner. Do not delay the process. If you are not feeling good enough physically, mentally and emotionally for more than 15 days, please reach out. And reaching out, I mean, and I think that the taboo around mental health, that when you meet a psychiatrist or a psychologist, that you are mad, should be stopped. I mean, we all have madness inside us, isn't it? I mean, if we are not mad, we would not live. There is some sort of madness in every person, but that can't be termed as madness when a person visits a practitioner. So encourage people, be there for them, support them. Now, today, I think the tagline itself this time is being access. You need to be accessible to people who are going through mental issues. And if somebody says that I am going through an issue, if you can't solve it, guide them to the nearest person. So children, if you are exhibiting or going through certain symptoms and signs that you cannot explain in words, try talking to your parents first. If that is not helping, get outside help from a professional. And I think teachers also should keep an open eye to get these signs and warnings early on.
Exactly.
If a child becomes reluctant or is slightly going to his own cocoon and not expressing the way he used to, then these are early signs. But then the way you deal with it is also very different. You can't be, I mean, going right and forth and then asking, are you mentally depressed or anxious? No, that's not the way forward. Now, there are subtle ways of dealing with it. So if you're not adept at it, then I think we should form a group or get into a proper counseling mode. Now, I would say mediation. I mean, more than counseling, it should be a mediation process where you are a mediator and then you facilitate certain things in them.
Thank you, ma'am. Yeah. Thank you. May I call upon Faisal, sir? The vote of
yeah, a lot of tips for teachers and parents we got. Okay, anyway, thanks. Okay,
I hope it was helpful, yeah. Sir.
So on behalf of Kendriya Vidyalaya Pattam, I would like to thank Srimadi K. Beena, writer and deputy director, Regional Outreach Bureau, Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, for organizing this very relevant and informative session for our school. We are thankful to Ms. Aparna Vishwanathan, Founder Director, Socio, Bangalore, for her very insightful and lively discussion and interaction with our students on the topic. I thank our principal, Sri Ajay Kumar, for all guidance and support, and Ms. Rashmi V and Ms. Rimi S. Babu, teachers of KV Pattam, for effectively coordinating this program. Thanks to all students, teachers, and parents who participated in this discussion and watched live on YouTube channel. Thanks to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank yeah. you.
Thank you. Thank you to KV Pattam. Thank you to Beena, ma'am. It's been a wonderful opportunity because I got an opportunity to interact with the students, which is very rare. So thank you so much.